money, mostly. Mostly. And they've always been there to make money. But there's also been a balance with just prestige. But what happened was that the other element, which is to make the most amount of money for the least amount of expenditure, after the phenomenon of Star Wars, unbalanced it, I think. It's not Lucas's doing. It's the type of person who suddenly got control of the studios.
I want to see your spaceship the moment the race is over.
Patience, my blue friend. You'll have your winnings before the sun set, and you'll be far away from here.
If anyone could do Star Wars and Jaws, then we would have had a lot of great movies since then. It's very hard to do Jaws and Star Wars. You have to be enormously talented. It's hard to be really good at anything. That's why movies, for the most part, are so bad. There just aren't that many good people around to do them. So it's not George and Steven's fault that the people who imitated them were bad.
But George got an autonomy. He didn't need it. He created his own world and his own industry in a way. And I must say, you know, if you want to know what's going to be the future in terms of the film industry, one goes up to San Francisco and visits George at the ranch.
Although Star Wars films are often associated with Hollywood, the maverick Lucas has always chosen to base himself and his companies 400 miles north of Tinseltown.
Who do you think you are?
I think moving to San Francisco, of course, George had been raised in Modesto, so he knew San Francisco a lot better than I did, and he liked San Francisco. I remember you were very positive. I moved here because I figured after we worked on this little movie that we did on the road, that pretty much you can make films anywhere, so you might as well just pick a place that you wanted to live in and then worry about. And San Francisco seemed like such a beautiful place and had a tradition of the poets and the writers, and it was smaller and it was a real city. It just seemed like a very a wonderful, you know, exciting adventure. We were young and just all move up to San Francisco and try to impact this new place.
Lucas's headquarters, the idyllic Skywalker Ranch, set in the rolling hills to the north of San Francisco, is the culmination of this dream. This enviable environment was made possible by the radical deal Lucas was able to secure for the Star Wars merchandising.
There was a desire to ask George to take a lower fee, to sort of, as it were, bet on his own movie. And As I've always understood the story, he said, okay, but then I want to keep the merchandising. And merchandising, which means all the toys, the clothing, the booklets, the, you know, that kind of thing. In fairness to the studio, merchandising was not regarded very highly in those days. Very little of it was done. It didn't earn very much money. So it was not the worst thing to say, well, if we can get him to reduce his fee by X dollars, what does it matter with the merchandising?
With the success of the film, the country goes Star Wars crazy. In the modern world, success can't be confined to one medium.
It's, you know, everybody sort of thinks that the toys were thought about before the movie, but they weren't. I mean, we didn't even start doing toys until about a year after Star Wars came out. It was like way after the fact. Star Wars had come and gone by the time they started doing toys and things. And then it turned into a business, and we sort of exploited it in order to keep the company going.
Star Wars has spawned more Star Wares than anyone can count. It has become an inescapable phenomenon.
You know, they had a shampoo that you could twist my head off and pour liquid out of my neck. And my ex-husband used to stick pins in the little doll. The little one. It's worse now. They have dolls that look like... I've always said the worst of my dolls look like Eddie Munster. But probably, you know, when I look at my worst, I have that quality.
I think the scope of fandom for this film scared me a lot. Making a decision like being in Star Wars makes you recognizable for most of your life. I mean, even if I stop tomorrow, you know, for another 10, 20 years, I'll probably be very recognizable. You don't want to lose your your life because you've chosen to do a film.
I mean, I used to go in through airports and have people say, Princess Leia! Like, I would then go, yes, you know, like that's my name.
There's a lot of mad people round about Star Wars too. Really frighteningly strange, freaky people. I'm starting to smell them coming up every now and again now. Starting to get a bit worrying, hanging around the stage door and stuff. I mean, I don't want to upset anybody, but, you know, there's something a bit strange. Some of them are quite all there. May the Force be with you. People actually say that to me, for real. And I'm supposed to, I don't know what I'm meant to do. May the Force be with you, Ewan. Like, don't be ridiculous. What are you talking about? But they do.
But it is just this fanaticism that seemingly guarantees the financial success of The Phantom Menace.
The budget was about $120 million. I think we brought in about $5 million under. It's about $115 million. About half of that was the shooting budget. The other half was a special effects budget.
Hello. I am C-3PO, Human Cyborg Relations. How might I serve you?
He's perfect.
You know, it's an expensive movie. The film has to be one of the top 10 grossing films of all time in order to break even. So, you know, not very many films do that. They're only... You know, I say there's less than 10 movies that have actually accomplished that. A lot of the movies that are being made now have to do that. I feel I got probably more of a shot than the other movies that are out there.
I don't know whether it will overtake Titanic. You're working in the outer limits of the stratosphere where it's really hard to measure. Is it going to do 1 billion 2 or 1 billion 1? I mean, you're talking like in hundreds of million fractions of hundreds of millions of dollars, like it was just a thing like that.
But the story doesn't end here.
We're starting work on episode 2 now. George is actually writing the second episode. We'll actually start shooting in 17 months. I start shooting in April of 2000. We'll start shooting in Europe. We have another 4 or 5 weeks to shoot in Tunisia and 4 or 5 weeks in Italy to shoot, and then we'll move to Australia and finish mid-2000, and then we'll be in post-production for 2 years, and the film will be out basically middle of May of the year 2002. And somewhere around 2001, we'll start on episode 3, prepping it and designing it. And then the process just is never ending.